Canal United distal and radius fractures. What is the displacement in a distal and radius fracture needs to be understood. The usual displacement that occurs in an extra-articular distal and radius fracture is posterior, dorsal, and lateral. So, the distal fragment is usually supinated, laterally displaced, there is an impaction, and there is a posterior displacement. These are the four things that occur, remembered by mnemonic slip. And when you treat them, distal and radius fracture, which are extra-articular, the classical Coley's fracture, you do opposite to it, pronation, palmar angulation, and ulnar deviation. So, a Coley's fracture usually occurs when you have a fall on the dorsiflex wrist, and a Smith fracture, the reverse Coley's, occurs when you have a fall on a palmar flex wrist. Now, a malunion occurs when a fracture bone heals with improper alignment. What is an alignment? So, there are three things that you should remember in the distal radial anatomy. The height, the inclination, and the tilt. So, what is the height? What is the inclination? And what is the tilt? So, height is that the radial styloid and the ulnar styloid, the difference is 11 millimeters. What is the tilt? The distal articular surface of the radius has a palmar tilt of about 12 degrees. And what's the radial inclination? It slides down. That is, the inclination of the radial surface, the difference between the lateral point of the radial surface, distal articular surface, and the medial point. There's a slope on which the scaphoid sleeps. So when we are comparing, this is normal anatomy. And when you do not align by this, it's called as malunion. So there's an incorrect length, articular incongruity, or combination of these. Malunions of distal radius may be intra-articular, extra-articular, may be symptomatic or asymptomatic. Malalignment or malunion does not always result in dysfunction. About 25% of radiological malunion is seen. Clinically, the symptomatic malunion is low, going to 5 to 7% following the various treatment methods. The common presentation that our patients will have a good functions. Vast majority of older, low demand patients function very well with the deformity. Risk factors for the loss of reduction, older age, 20 degrees of dorsal angulation, dorsal metaphyseal combination causing a collapse, combination extending to the volar metaphyseal cortex, associated fracture of the ulnar styloid, displaced joint injury, fractures. Fracture of the distal radius heal rapidly. A malaligned healing fracture can be considered a malunion within 4 to 6 weeks of injury. It's a metaphyseal injury. So basic criteria to define malunion is radial inclination in less than 10 degrees, either a volar tilt of more than 20 degrees or a dorsal tilt of more than 20 degrees, and a radial height of less than 10 millimeters. Ulna variance of plus 2. Normally, this ulna is shorter, negative, but it becomes more, positive. An intra-articular step or gap of more than 2 millimeters. So if we look again, this is the shortening or the radial height I spoke of. This is the inclination or the slope that the lateral and medial surface has. This is the articular slope. And this is the tilt, normally 11 degrees, but if it is more than 20 degrees in either direction, it is an indication for correction. Malunion can be predicted in a patient with Coley's type of fracture when the volar cortex, which is the strongest portion of metaphyseal, is not in contact. So if the volar aspect is not in contact, there will be a malunion. In these situations, any significant dorsal combination is more likely to collapse as the thin bone fragments are resorbed due to the loss of buttress of the intact volar cortex. When the volar cortex is intact, it appears to help resist the collapse of this dorsal combination. So there is a dorsal displacement in combination, but if the volar cortex is intact, it will still preserve it, otherwise it is going to malunite. The natural history, they don't correlate with the radiology. The symptoms are different. Ulnar-sided wrist pain, can improve for a year or more after fracture of the distal radius, so patience is required. Lack of forearm rotation may be related to capsular contractures or bony malalignment. For slight malunions, patience with exercise and rehabilitation is advisable. While it is often stated that an extra-articular distal radius malunion leads to future arthritis, there are no data to support this contention. After a recovery period of 1 to 2 years from fracture, the functional deficit seems fairly stable. So, a usual thing that you can ask the patient to do is straight namaste and an ulta namaste. And this is a good assessment of the wrist dorsiflexion and the wrist palmarflexion. And you can also see the pronation and supination exercises, which can be good in these patients. Intra-articular malunions produce irregular articular surface, which can cause later arthrosis or arthritis. Extra-articular malunions after intracarpal, radiocarpal and distal joint mechanics alter them. Grip strength is reduced. TFCC, triangular fibrocartilage complex strain, may produce constant ulnar pain on activity. Altered loading patterns and premature osteoarthritis is quite possible. Pain alone is not a good indication for corrective osteotomies or malunion. Pain should be discrete and specific. Vague, diffuse or disproportionate pain should not be treated with osteotomies. Lack of motion should be clearly due to malalignment, not due to pain or squeamishness, like instability of the distal radial ulnar joint. Ulnocarpal compression. The carpus is forcefully ulnarly divided towards the ulna. Consistent reproduction of usual pain with ulnar deviation task is inconsistent with ulnocarpal impaction. The examiner can test for distal radial joint instability by the ballotment that is clearly shown in the videos by Professor Anindra. You can have a scaphoid shift test. Instability would indicate a possible scaphoid intraosseous ligament tear, indicating a potential dissociative rather than the typical non-dissociative carpal malalignment usually associated with distal radius malunion. Grip strength is one measure of wrist dysfunction, but it is largely determined by pain and effort, both strongly influenced by the psychosocial factors one should keep in mind. Conservative. Non-operative management is appropriate for a low-demand patient. Splints are weaned after 6 weeks of cast immobilization. Normal activities are resumed in 3 or 4 months with good physiotherapy. Patience is required, in particular if a patient with ulnar sinus pain thought due to an extra-articular malunion. This discomfort is the last pain to go away from a distal radius fracture, routinely lasts up to a year. When the issue is restriction of motion and there is less than 20 degrees of dorsal tilt or less than 5 mm of ulnar positive variance, a non-operative approach may be warranted. So this is the criteria where you should think about a non-operative management, less than 20 degree of dorsal tilt and less than 5 mm of ulnar positive variance. Whereas an operative treatment, patients presenting with radiographic evidence of malunion combined with clinical symptoms consistent with that diagnosis should be strongly considered for surgical correction of the deformity. So when you have radiographic evidence of malunion, clinical symptoms where of consistent with the diagnosis, you should think about the surgery. Decreased grip strength, decreased mobility, increasing pain, difficulties in activities of daily living, worsened cosmesis, poor DASH score, carpal tunnel syndrome are few indications. When should we operate? The preferred timing for treatment of malunion has been the subject of some debate. Proponents of delayed treatment suggest that waiting for complete fracture consolidation and resolution of osteopenia may make bony distraction and fixation easier at the time of osteotomy. However, it is now believed that the potential disadvantage far outweighs the benefits of this approach. In these cases, fracture collapse is followed quickly by tightening of the soft tissue envelopes. As the tendons, nerves and other structures become shortened, distractions will become more and more difficult, especially if you wait up to a year after the injury. But in younger individuals with high demands, it is preferred to treat malunion as soon as they are detected. If discovered within 4 to 8 weeks, the early fracture callus is easily distinguished for the firmer cortical bone and can be readily removed and anatomical alignment can be restored. In a study comparing early to late malunion reconstructions, Jupiter and Ring found that earlier reconstruction was both technically easier and resulted in a shorter period of disability. The desired angular, rotational and length corrections are planned based on pre-operative radiographic studies including an X-ray of the opposite rift if uninjured.